Unternehmung zur Vorsorge des Handels wurde es für die Bank gelegt.
First of all, I'm very honored and privileged to be here with you. It seems like I'm repeating myself because I said the same thing downstairs just an hour ago. Very honored to be, to be here with you and have this opportunity to speak with you, such a great group. The group downstairs was very interactive, very energetic, so I hope that we have the same level of energy. No? We will do our best in this discussion. My name is George, and I serve in San Antonio's Church in Hayward, in San Francisco. And I am heavily involved in the field of apologetics, and that's defending the Christian faith. Do a lot of on-campus ministries, interfaith clubs for Coptic clubs throughout universities in California, and non-Copts as well. So I would like to today talk to you about defending the faith or the field of apologetics. I don't want to throw out those names. Apologetics basically means defending the Christian faith and the trends that we as Copts, as Christians rather, encounter and face, challenges that we face here in the West, in the 21st century West. So without adding more to the introduction, I would like to begin by showing you, well, the clip is going to come next, okay? There's a little video clip that's going to come in the middle of the presentation. So, defending the Christian faith. Anybody heard of the term apologetics? You have. Very good. Apologetics basically doesn't mean to apologize for something. It basically means to defend one's stand. One that believes in something, to defend that stand is apologetics. Now, Christianity, along with her moral values and principles, has been under severe attack in recent years. Would you agree with that? Subtle and non-subtle. Some blatant and some very subtle. From without and from within. From outside and from within the church itself. And we will see what these attacks are like. Now if you look at, of course, these attacks have been channeling themselves, their ways, into our communities through the media, through politics, through so many different facets of society. If you look at this picture right here, anybody heard of there's probably no God campaign in London? I'm sure Bishop Anginus would affirm that. Anybody heard of those campaigns? Yeah. You have. Very good. Pretty popular campaigns. There's probably no God. Stop worrying and enjoy your life. God doesn't exist. The Da Vinci Code. Of course, we all heard of the Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown and what he said. You know, Christ was married to Mary Magdalene and all these things. Going to hell and proud. These are taking these pictures from the San Francisco demonstration right across from City Hall where I used to work. We all heard of Madonna and her making fun of the crucifixion. And of course, anybody knows what that is? Golden Compass, exactly. And how that was an anti-Christian. In essence, this was a response to another movie by C.S. Lewis, a book that C.S. Lewis wrote, The Chronicles of Narnia. That was a response to that movie. So we see this day in and day out on college campuses. You see this day in and day out, subtle attacks against our Christian faith. How do we deal with these attacks?
This is how we deal with it. Be quiet. Think very loud. Okay. I'll try to project my voice as much as I can.
Maybe battery didn't die. Maybe mistakenly so. Okay. How do we deal with these attacks? Oh, by the way, these other attacks from within the church. Anybody heard of her? Joyce Meyer? The laughing, the smiling preacher? Joel Osteen? You know how many people are in his congregation? 40,000. Houston Rockets Stadium was now converted to his church. And anybody knows who this guy is? Benny Hinn, exactly. So these are... They call themselves Christians, but they're far from Christians. This is a whole different discussion altogether. They follow something called the Word of Faith movement, and we can talk about that another time. So attacks are coming like fiery darts to our faith, challenging us. I was discussing with them downstairs questions like, as a matter of fact, and at the end of, I think, page 20 in your book, I listed some questions that I want you to think about. Think about so that we can discuss by the end of this convention. Questions that are real questions from real people, Copts, just like yourselves. Number one, all religions worship the same God. We are all climbing the same mountain. It doesn't matter who you believe, as long as you are sincere in your belief, you're going to go to heaven. I cannot believe in a God that sends people to hell. I'm an atheist. I don't need God to live a good moral life. Given the varied cultural practices in the world, I'm convinced that morality, which basically says right and wrong, good and bad, is defined by the culture or by the individual. So is morality defined by the culture that we live in? Number five is a good one. To claim that Jesus is God offends non-Christians. True. To claim that he is a madman offends Christians. True. To claim that he's just a good moral teacher promotes tolerance. I'm sure you've come across these statements or these examples. It doesn't matter what you believe, as long as you're okay. What about those who have never heard of Christ? What's going to happen to them? If God, this is an interesting one, we'll discuss it at length downstairs. If God is all-powerful and all-loving, then he can and would want to get rid of evil, yet evil exists. Therefore, God is not all-powerful, not all-loving, God doesn't exist. This is called the rock of atheism. So these are questions that I personally have discussed at length with college students on college campuses, with Christians and non-Christians, atheists, agnostics, all of them. How do we as Christians, how can we equip ourselves as Christians to defend logically and intellectually, to defend the Christian faith against all these attacks, subtle and non-subtle? We're going to discuss. So, times have been changing over the past 40 years. Historians and sociologists have been calling this time the time of postmodernism. Anybody heard of the term postmodernism? You have. Very good. We will discuss postmodernism a little bit today. I'll give you a background of how we got to this era. Jim Leffel said in his book, Postmodernism, The Spirit of the Age, he said, we live in strange times. 20 years ago, Christianity was under attack because it was thought to be unscientific. And consequently, untrue. Today, Christianity is still under attack. Not because it has been examined and found unscientific, but merely because it claims to be true. So the mere claim to truth itself indicates that you are an intolerant, fanatic, fundamentalist person. You cannot claim that truth exists. And what's the backbone of our society, ideologically, is that relativism, moral relativism, basically everything is relative to the individual. What's good to you, what's good for you, may not be good for me. What you deem as good, I may deem as bad. And that is basically the background noise of our culture nowadays. Give you some statistics from Barna, www.barna.org. Barna Research Group conducted a study asking 3,000 professed Christians. These are professed, in other words, they claim to be Christians. Then the results are pretty staggering. 63% don't believe that Christ is the Son of God. These are professed Christians. 58 evangelical Christians, I mean that. 58% believe all religions teach equally valid truths. If you're Hindu, Buddhist, we're all teaching the same thing. They're all teaching the same thing. 51% do not believe that Christ rose from the dead. 68% do not believe that the Holy Spirit is a real person. So these are staggering statistics that you can actually see for yourself, and a lot more alarming stats than this. So, why bother? Why are we having this discussion and talking about defending our faith? By the way, I think the setting doesn't allow for interactive discussion. Personally, I like the setting downstairs better, but that's just my personal opinion, where it's more... anyways, so I'd like to... more of a circle, so that we can actually have a discussion. So I'm gonna walk around. Why bother? Why are we talking about defending our faith? Please help me make this.
Very good, excellent.
If you lived in Egypt, you're either Muslim or you're Christian. You don't have to deal with anything. Postmodernism, I don't know nowadays what it is like, but postmodernism, relativism, pluralism, all those isms, they don't exist in Egypt. You're either Muslim or Christian. The discussion we had downstairs was about atheism and agnosticism. How we can prove that God really exists, logically speaking. But we don't have to deal with that if we lived in Egypt. But if we live in here, as you mentioned, as Christine mentioned, we live in a multicultural world. society. We have so many different religions. Even, by the way, we don't call them religions nowadays. They're called worldviews. So when you go, and again, these are college campus terms. What's your worldview? They don't ask what's your religion. Religion now implies that you're either, you know, one or two or three, four categories. Worldview basically simply means that what is your view of the world? How do you make up your view of the world? Because I can have my own religion, that is just George's religion. And I can just basically fabricate, take like a cafeteria approach, take from what I like. And that's, by the way, this is what people have been advocating, the tolerance movement. So why bother, besides multiculturalism or multicultural world? What else?
To strengthen your own faith?
Exactly. Exactly. If I come to you and ask you one of those questions, can you please, what's your name?
John,
can you please tell me, how do we prove that God exists? Science cannot prove he exists, therefore he doesn't exist. Please respond. And I'm an atheist, I'm an agnostic, I'm a roommate of yours in college, and I'm asking these questions. How do we come back to that question? Not so that we can win the argument and say, hey, I want an argument, but at least so that we can actually be true to our faith and maybe win his soul, not the argument. How do we answer those questions? So very good. Strengthen our own faith. What else? Any other reason? Why bother? Okay, well, three reasons very quickly. I'll go over them very quickly. God commands it. Reason demands it. And the world needs it. God commands it, reason demands it, and the world needs it. And I'm not going to go into this at length. I'll just give you the scriptural references and I'll move on. God commands it, you'll see it in all these verses and so many other. I'll just give you the very first one because it's very, very well put, obviously. Always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. By the way, the word defense in the original Greek is apologetics or apologia. That's where the word apologetics came from. Always be ready to give a defense. I was asking downstairs someone, how do you explain to me that objective moral values exist and point to an objective moral being in whom these values are anchored? She said, well, give me 5 minutes on Google and I'll let you know. You can't. You can't do that when you're talking to some atheist that's actually asking you these questions. God commands it, reason demands it. We should love God with all our what? All our heart, soul, and mind. Some people say that if you just, all you need is faith. Don't worry about reason or your intellect. That's against faith. Absolutely wrong. Absolutely unbiblical. Faith and reason are both going hand in hand. The world needs it, of course, the multitude of verses that tell you that the world needs it. We also need it. We're part of that world. We are called to be salt and earth, salt and light to the world. Okay. For us to talk about attacks, we're implying the existence of an enemy. Right? And the existence of an enemy here comes to us on two fronts. Two fronts, cultural and ideological. The cultural enemy basically is the enemy that we live with. The behavioral enemy. Our lifestyle, our language. And then the other enemy is the ideological one. One is the cause of the effect. Our thinking, our thoughts influence how this culture behaves and becomes a dynamic culture. So, philosophies, schools of thought, Darwin, for example, came up with an ideological influence to say, well, there's a theory of evolution, although he never stated that it's more than a theory, but of course, many philosophers and thinkers and atheists have taken this theory and claimed it to be fact, conclusive fact. And then a school of thought had emerged out of his ideological thinking. Oh, evolution must explain the origin of species based on this book. So, cultural enemy comes to us in various forms, three forms. Man is God, and that view is called humanism. Anybody heard of humanism? Man is the measure of all things. It's all about me. Some philosopher called the 21st century, it's the century of the me generation. It's all about me. Humanism. You shall be like God, as the serpent said. The other cultural enemy, materialism. I don't think we can have any disagreement with that. Acquisition of money, material good, is the highest ultimate goal. Money is God. So first, man is God. Money is God. Third, can anyone guess? Hedonism. Sensual pleasure is the highest good. Pleasure is God. The motto of the 1970s was that if it feels good, then do it. Hugh Hefner came up with that slogan, and everybody had taken that and ran with it. If it feels good, do it. Sensual pleasure became the God of the 21st century. So materialism, hedonism, and humanism, these are the cultural enemies that we as Christians need to be made aware of. What about the, can we look at a biblical perspective to these cultural enemies? These coincide with this verse, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life. If you were to take these three, you will put this one in humanism, you will put this one in materialism, you will put this one in hedonism. And these are the cultural enemies that St. John had talked about almost 2,000 years ago. One by one. St. Paul also talked about them. If you look at 2 Timothy 3:1-5, but know this, that in the last days, we probably are living in those last days, difficult times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves. What is that? Humanism. Lovers of money. Materialism. Lovers of pleasure. Hedonism, rather than lovers of God. That's what St. Paul said. That's what St. John said. These are the cultural enemies that are not new to us, but we need to be made aware of them. Any questions so far? What about the ideological enemies? These are a little more intense and more dangerous, by the way, because they cause cultural trends in our society. Atheism believes that there's no God. Very rampant on college campuses. Actually, I show a statistic downstairs when I talk about atheism. According to the Toronto Star, 43%. I can get you the exact quote, 43% of people that live in the city of Vancouver do not hold belief in any deity or any god. And this is coming from the Toronto Star that was published, I think, maybe a year ago or so. 43%, it's a lot of people. It's one out of two people believe that God doesn't exist or God is something other than the God of the Bible. Atheism, agnosticism, a little fancier way to be an atheist now is to say I'm agnostic. Anybody here have friends or talk to people that are agnostics? Yeah, I'm an agnostic. You know what agnostic means? A is the opposite. A means the opposite of in Greek, the alpha. Gnosis in Greek means to know. This is how we came up with the word know. It comes from gnosis in Greek. That's why we have K, and we don't pronounce it in English, because it's a G in Greek, and we don't pronounce it. Gnosis. So gnosis means to know. Agnostic means do not know. I don't know if there's a God, and maybe I don't want to know if there's a God. So people say, I think I'm agnostic. It's a fancier, more fashionable way to say that I'm an atheist. Why is that? Atheism became very simple and indefensible. For you to deny the existence of a being, this being must first exist for you to deny his existence. G.K. Chesterton said this, if there was no God, there would be no atheists. The existence of atheists implied the existence of God whom you are trying to deny. How can you deny something that doesn't even exist? So atheism became very philosophically simple and indefensible. Another thing for atheism, since we have this up in agnosticism, for you to say that you are an atheist and hold your ground to be an atheist, logically speaking, you have to have infinite knowledge of a being that has infinite knowledge. For example, if I were to say, I believe that in the city of Vancouver, there is no stone, there's no 3x5 red stone with yellow dots in it. In the city of Vancouver, there doesn't exist a 3x5 yellow stone with red dots. What am I implying? That I have searched the entire city of Vancouver, inch by inch, to see if really, in fact, a 3x5 yellow stone with red dots might exist. I'm implying that in my statement. So atheism implies that you have searched, read all the books in the world, searched everywhere in the world, to see that there is no being with infinite knowledge, and you must have that infinite knowledge to say that no being with infinite knowledge exists. Do you see? So atheism became very simple, logically speaking. So now people switched and shifted in the 21st century to agnosticism. Ah, well, maybe he gets, and I actually had an interview downstairs, a video clip downstairs with an interview I was conducting in one of the colleges of a lady. I was asking her, who do you think God is? What is God to you? She said, well, God may exist for someone, but he doesn't exist for me. How illogical is this? It's as if saying, this chair may exist for you, but this chair doesn't exist for you. How sustainable is that? This chair either exists for everyone, or it doesn't for everyone. And if he exists for you, it's because you can't see it. If you say he doesn't exist, it's because you can't see it, not because it doesn't exist. Do you see the logical fallacy in that? Okay, pluralism. We're going to talk about this in the discussion tomorrow. Pluralism is the common belief that all religions worship the same God. It's like, imagine the mountain. Christianity is climbing here, and Hinduism is here, Islam, Buddhism, and we're all going to converge at the top. Religious pluralism. We're all worshiping the same God. You'd be amazed on how much this worldview is common, prevalent on college campuses. You'd be amazed. Go to college, go on your college campus and in quad and raise a state or a board that says Christianity is the only true religion. And have someone else say, all religions are true, this promotes tolerance. Which one would be frowned upon? Remember the quote by Jim Leffel that said Christianity is now under attack because it claims to be true? Okay. Comments or questions? Are you guys experiencing these things? Okay. Relativism, that's the other subtopic we'll be discussing tomorrow as well. Morality is relative to the individual. How did you get your concept of right and wrong? Well, my culture came up with this concept, and it's culturally defined. Or my parents, my household came up with this concept, or I had come up with that concept that morality is relative to the individual. A concept called moral relativism. Again, very important ideological enemies to our Christian faith that are being, that have infiltrated our society, even most importantly in the field of academics. You take a philosophy course in college, just one philosophy, or a biology course in college, any sociology course in college, you'll encounter all of these concepts and enemies. And last, all this is summarized in the age of postmodernism. Age of postmodernism, as we will discuss in subsequent lectures. So, this guy, Jan Veith, he said that the age of postmodernism is characterized by two things. More than that, but just primarily two things. The death of truth. Truth doesn't exist. You cannot claim to hold the truth or to have lay hold of the truth. Truth doesn't exist. Subsequently, moral absolutes do not exist. Morality now becomes relative. He said, it's hard to proclaim the forgiveness of sins to people who believe that since morality is relative, they have no sins to forgive. Who's to say I'm a sinner? You say I'm a sinner, I'm not. What's the point of reference? There's no point of reference. I come up with a point of reference. Now this is when I'll take a little break and I'll show you a video about absolute truth. This was an interview I had, I believe, in two universities, UC Berkeley. Those of you who know Berkeley, extremely liberal, ruthless when it comes to things like that, and San Jose State University. And I was asking students, selected random students, on what they see or what they think of truth, if they believe in absolute truth. And what I say absolute truth is that a truth that is all binding for all people at all times and all places. Truth is all that is all binding for all people at all times and all places. Let's see what the responses were.
Do you believe that there is a truth that's true for everyone?
No, I don't.
So you're saying truth is relative?
Yeah, I think truth varies from person to person, depending on their situation.
It's relative to each person. It just totally depends on how they're raised and what they morally learn in their like early years of life.
But, I don't know, not really.
Is truth absolute? For everyone, at all times, in all places, or is it relative?
It's relative. It's relative to each person in each situation. Each person.
No. I don't believe that we should want it.
Are you saying truth is relative to the individual?
Yeah. Yeah, I believe that it depends on the way you construct your values, your morals, and I guess from that you will judge what's truth and what's not.
About absolute truth?
This is a funny question.
If like 5 out of 10 persons say that it's true, so okay, I'll say.
You haven't believed in that Jesus is absolute truth.
Similar with what he said, you know, I think it depends on the person, you know, like, you know, when you grew up and, you know, hear your own experiences and you know what truth is and moral truth, I mean, and, you know, your parents teach you, you know, your friends, and, you know, it just depends on, like, you know, where you're influenced to and your peers and who you hang with, you know, so.
Okay, the thing is, I'm Christian, so basically that's already kind of a bias. So we are talking about absolute truth, and that's an absolute truth for me, but that doesn't mean that it should be for everyone else. So it's something very personal.
I don't think it's absolute.
An absolute truth? No absolute truth. That's just too deep. I mean, there are truths, but an absolute truth, that's kind of altruistic, that's kind of righteous, that's kind of saying I'm right and you're wrong. No absolute truth.
Would you say that truth is relative to each person?
Absolutely. Absolutely, truth is relative to each person.
Did you hear that? Very interesting. If they were to listen to the illogical claims they're making, by saying that truth is relative, basically the relativists, all of them, say that truth is relative except the statement that truth is relative. You see? If truth is relative, then so the statement that truth is relative would be relative. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So, and he illustrated this very well. He said, truth is relative, absolutely. So wait a minute, so there is an absolute truth. That truth is relative. Do you see what I'm saying? You cannot escape that circular argument. Philosophically speaking, it's a circular argument. You cannot escape the fact that truth is absolute. To have a dialogue and a discussion, you must have an absolute, or else you wouldn't have a dialogue or a discussion. It would be just mere opinions. Okay? Have you been in any court that says, a court that says, I swear to tell my opinion, nothing but my opinion, and the whole opinion? Of course not. Yes, ma'am. Very good. Okay. Absolute truth is a term that simply means a point of reference that is binding for all people at all times and all places. In other words, when I say, for example, morally speaking, if I say killing innocent babies is wrong, bad, is this moral statement binding for everyone, at all times, in all places? Or is it good for you? But for me, I think killing innocent people for fun is probably okay. You see what I'm saying now? So there is an absolute moral truth. And once you establish that absolute truth, you cannot escape the fact that there is an absolute truth giver, or that absolute moral law implies the moral law giver, who is God. In other words, an atheist, I'm sorry?
Like the reference point.
Like the reference point, exactly. And for example, one of the questions you have in your booklet, I do not need God, I'm an atheist, I do not need God to live a good moral life. I've had people ask me that question all the time. How can you respond back to this, to such a question? There's something wrong with the question itself. One key word that the atheist cannot logically defend, the word good. I'm an atheist. I do not need God to live a good moral life. What is good? How did you come up with the concept of good? Or another question that I'll move on to real quick. The rock of, yes ma'am?
How about instinct?
Instinct, very good. I have my instinct that may very well be different from your instinct.
But a little child, when he does something wrong, even though nobody told him before that what he did is wrong, he sort of, you know, the house is suddenly quiet and you know he's doing something wrong.
Right.
He knows that.
Right.
So it's built in somehow.
What's built in? Very good, it's built in, but what's built in?
Built in is more accurate than instinct. How?
A child knows that something is inappropriate.
Right.
Even though nobody told him before, because he, I don't know.
Very good. By the way, if you read Romans 1, that will explain it to you, because God had imprinted that moral law on each of our hearts. Some people may call it the conscience. Okay? Yes, sir. I'll get to your point in 1 second.
That's what I was going to say, the conscience, and then I think the Holy Spirit as well.
Very good.
Helps you. Sorry.
Very good. But then here's the question. The better question than this is, how did these moral laws come unto us and became binding for us? These moral laws imply that there is someone that had fashioned these laws. They don't just come. I'll give you another example. Another question to the evil question, the rock of atheism. They call it the rock of atheism, the problem of evil. So many people say, some many atheists say, I don't believe in God because there's so much evil in the world. So much evil. Look at all this evil in the world. How can a good, loving God?
Look at you. Sorry. I mean.
Yeah. Well, that wouldn't be a good argument from a Christian. You would win the argument, but you would lose the soul. And you want to win the soul, even if you have to lose the argument. But anyways, so look at all this evil in the world. And then, yes. Okay, just finish my point real quickly. And then you were to say, well, the existence of evil proves the existence of God. How is that? The existence of evil cannot be evil without the existence of good. Because what is evil in essence? It's the absence of good. Much like darkness, it's the absence of light. Cold is the absence of heat. The existence of evil implies the existence of good. You cannot say this is evil unless you already have an idea of what good is. C.S. Lewis said in Mere Christianity, he said, I cannot say that this line is crooked unless I have an idea of what a straight line looks like. You see? So if you say this is evil, you're implying the existence of good. And if you're implying the existence of good, you're implying the existence of a point of reference, a moral law, based on which you determine what is good and what is evil. And if you're implying the existence of a moral law, you're implying the existence of a moral lawgiver, whom you are trying to deny. Do you see? So evil leads to good, leads to a moral law, leads to a moral lawgiver. This is how the problem of evil leads to the existence of God. But if you were to think about, if you were to break it down, logically speaking, yes, sir.
But what if they say that moral lawgiver is society and not Jesus?
Very good. Very good point. Moral law cannot be society if you're, I mean, given that you're talking to the same person. Cannot be society. I'll tell you why. One of the questions here. I put for you number, where is it? Number four. Given the very cultural practices in the world, I'm convinced that morality is defined by culture. By the way, I'm digressing a little bit, and I'm going to go back to this in a second. So after this question, I'll go back to the discussion, so that we can have that continuity. So, moral law cannot be defined by culture. Cannot, logically speaking. You know why? There are two different things you have to look at to discern. What is the case? What ought to be the case? What is the case is descriptive statements. What ought to be the case are prescriptive statements. So, let me give you an example and it will become more clear. Culture executes a pre-existing moral law. And there's a distinction between values and facts. We can alter our perception of the facts so that we wouldn't have problems and conflicts with the values. Values are all binding across all cultures. I'll give you an example. Abortion. If you were to talk to a pro-choice young lady and say, ask this young lady, pro-choice, she wants to do whatever she wants, do you think killing innocent babies, is it good or bad? If she's the same young lady, she will say, what? Bad. Why? Because it's a value that you cannot escape, that's been imprinted on your heart. In Romans 1, you see that. But I can change the facts and my perception of the facts so that I wouldn't have a conflict with the value. But wait a minute, these are not babies. They're not babies until they're born, so I can still kill them. Do you see? So the facts alter, the values don't. I'll give you another example. The Holocaust. Hitler said, he was asked, killing innocent people, is it good or bad? And same person will say, bad. Hitler was asked that question. He said, no one should kill innocent people. When he was asked this question about killing 6 million Jews or however many Jews he killed, he said, well, these are not people. They are subhuman.
Maybe they're not innocent.
Well, and he said, well, he didn't even recognize that they're people altogether. In one of his books, he said they are subhuman. By the way, Hitler was influenced by another philosopher. His name is Friedrich Nietzsche, and the philosophy that God is dead influenced that Hitler, that these are not human. So what the Hitler did is He changed the facts so that the value wouldn't have a conflict. So there's a difference that we need to understand. Culture does not define morality. Culture executes a pre-existing moral code that is in you, that you need to ask yourself, where did it come from? That's my point. Okay, any questions? Let's move on. How did we get there? I'll give you a slide that will basically the history of the world from a religious religious perspective. Lack of a better word. You will have from the first century to our time, our era. The first to the probably 18th century was characterized by a pre-modern era, a lot of theists. Schools of thought. Theism was predominant. God had a relationship with the world. He created the world, sustained the world, and was involved in the matters of the world, and those who lived in the world. Now comes the 19th to probably late 20th century. Theism changed into atheism. Well, God no longer needs to exist. It's only us. That led to what? Remember the humanism and all these isms we talked about? All came right here. Karl Marx was a prominent figure. Immanuel Kant, David Hume, Sigmund Freud, we can go on and on. All these figures that had developed these ideological schools of thought had influenced this era to become an atheistically driven era. Then we come to our 21st century, the era that we are living in now. Very interesting. You basically say, God exists, no God, whatever works for you. Basically, that's what it is. This is the era of what? Postmodernism, from pre-modern to modern to postmodernism. We can spend about 2 hours discussing this slide in details, but just to spare you the misery. Friedrich Nietzsche, Deepak Chopra. Anybody heard of Deepak Chopra? Indian? You've heard of him. Very good. You've heard of him. Anybody listen to Dr. Swire, his disciple? Bald guy? Okay, Shirley MacLaine, and so many Steven Spielberg, so many other prominent Hollywood figures, influential figures that believe in the whatever works for you. You come up with your own, not religion, your own what?
Worldview.
Your own worldview, exactly. Construct your own faith and live by it. That's the era we are currently living in. By the way, we'll never know that we are living in this era unless we step back and look at it, much like a fish will never know that it's wet because it's always living in water. It has to come outside the water and look at the water from outside. So we ought to look back and say, where are we going? From a theistic to atheistic, to pluralistic. Pluralistic basically means it's all good. Let's just hold hands and live happy. And after all, we need to promote tolerance and diversity. And I have to say one thing about diversity. In corporate America, those of you who work in corporations, I'm sure some of you have taken diversity training. You have to be able to, right? Diversity classes. We feel, or we advocate, that we pride ourselves by being a diverse nation. And we get our strength from diversity. True or false? That's what we say. But is it true that our strength comes from diversity? Absolutely, yes. What? Truths that are contradictory to one another. Very good. But is diversity the secret of our strength? Absolutely not. You can have a diverse group coming from all different nations and backgrounds and ethnic backgrounds, but if we don't have what? Unity within diversity, there's no strength, power, or flourishing or prosperity or anything like that. So it's the unity within diversity that gives you power and strength that this nation flourishes upon. Hence the term university. It was coming out of what? Bringing unity within diversity. It's the quest of all philosophers across all times to bring unity in diversity, and that's the essence of the term university. The only one that was able to bring unity to this diverse world was the God of the Bible, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was able to bring unity within diversity in His perfect unity in diversity, being Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Diverse yet united. But that's another discussion that we can talk about. Any questions on this so far? Okay, postmodern, this is the fun part that I hope we can have some interaction in. Postmodernism in action. See some buzzwords, what do you call them? Buzzwords or mouth bites that are overheard on college campuses and everywhere else. No one has the right to tell me what's right and what's wrong. By the way, nod at least if you agree that this has been said and that you've heard this before. Nod so I can feel better. I cannot tell you what's right and what's wrong. You must decide that for yourself. Right? Amen. I like that. Amen. It's wrong to impose your morals on someone else. What's wrong with that statement?
It's a moral.
Very good. It's a moral that's being imposed. I have the right to do whatever I want as long as I'm not hurting anyone. Very good. Now what's the problem with this? What's your definition of hurt? Hurt. Just like the atheist that says, I can live a good life without God. What's good? See, if you were just to basically throw their argument back on itself in a circular way, you will expose the fallacy and the premise so that the argument will falter, will fall. Okay, look, that's your opinion. Who's to say this is right and this is wrong? You should not judge. Britney Spears, I bring that up and everybody gets, you know, gets your attention. Her sister. I forget her name. Thank you. She was pregnant out of wedlock, if you all know the story. And then she was being interviewed by a reporter, and the reporter asked her, so what do you think of having a baby out of wedlock? She said three things. You should not judge. Don't judge me. I don't want to be judged. She left it at that. Basically, someone said, some philosopher by the name of Rabbi Zacharias said, that the most quoted verse in the scriptures for 2,000 years have been John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he has given his only begotten son. Now, this has changed. The most quoted verse in the scriptures is Matthew 7:1. You should not judge. Of course, take it out of context. Okay, so let's look at these postmodern claims. These are postmodern claims. This is the world we're living in, by the way. And the reason why I'm sharing this with you is to give you an inkling to equip us as a body of Christ, to equip us with tools that we can, one, defend our faith with meekness and love, two, more importantly, to share our faith with others. Because we are not here by chance or by accident. We are here to share and radiate the love of Christ unto everyone we come across. Everyone. And how much in need this world is for that peace and love that Christ can give and nobody else can give. So that's the reason why we're having this discussion. How we can first defend our position as Christians and how we can share our faith with others. So there is no absolute truth. What do you say to that? What do you say to that statement?
Maryse, right? Maryse, please.
Huh? That's an absolute truth.
Very good. So what do you say? What's the question you say to that? You ask,
what is an absolute truth?
There's no absolute truth. You probably want to ask and say, is that absolutely true?
Okay? Okay. Well,
let me actually go from there. There's no absolute truth. Is that absolutely true? You'll get the point after the second one. You cannot know truth. What do you say to that? And that's an agnosticism, by the way. Any agnostic will say, you cannot know truth. What do you say? Very good. Or in other words, then how do you know that? How do you know that? You cannot know truth. Well, how do you know? You must know what truth is for you to say that there's no truth. Truth is relative. This is a funny one. Truth is relative. What do you say?
To what?
Very good. To what?
Is a very good answer to that. What else?
Is that a relative statement?
Very good. Who said that? I'm actually
going to. Deacon with a good voice and also good intuition. Truth is relative. Is that a relative truth? If you're saying truth is relative, then all truths must be relative, including the statement that truth is relative. You see? It's true for you, but not for me. We heard that before. It's true for you, but not for me. What do you say?
Huh?
That it must not be true for you.
Very good. I like that answer. What else? Yes, ma'am.
I'm just going to say, like, haven't you ever watched a movie or read a book? You know when we do Bible study and everybody reads a verse and you ask people what stood out for you? Everybody's looking at the same verse, reading the same thing, but different parts show up and mean to you.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe when these questions are being asked to people, that's what they're thinking. They're not necessarily thinking it this way.
Yeah.
It's coming from a different perspective.
But that was not the context in which these questions were asked. I mean, I see your point, but when we're talking about truth that is somewhat absolute in nature rather than preferences or, you know, yeah, like I like chocolate versus vanilla ice cream rather than whether...
I'm just asking, like, do you think everybody understood that in the interview?
Absolutely.
You know, because I'm not sure that everybody...
Absolutely.
Like, really looked as silly.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm using this intentionally, by the way. Absolutely.
But good point, but I want to make that distinction between, well, yeah, it could be true for me, but not for you from an existential standpoint. Like, I feel this way, or maybe you feel something else. I agree with you. But that's not the context in which these were asked. We're talking about truth with a capital T. That's all binding. That has nothing to do with feeling and preference. Yes?
So, like, when you're asking people if they believe there's absolute truth, then they ask you what absolute truth is. What do you say? Because I still don't, like, I know you answered me already, but I still don't understand.
Who can very succinctly say what absolute truth is? Or what I mean by absolute truth?
I understand what absolute truth is, but I don't understand how it's relative to what we're discussing.
Okay. If you say that absolute truth exists, you must imply that God exists. And the reason why people don't want to believe in absolute truth, they don't want to believe in an absolute being. In whom the truth is anchored. Who said about himself, I am the truth. Do you see? So people don't want to escape this absolutism of truth. Because if you agree with it, you cannot escape the existence of a deity. In whom this truth is anchored. Do you see? It follows that logic. So, do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand. So that when you ask people, you say, is it relative? Well, isn't it relative? Because everyone has their own religion. And they're all following the deity.
Yeah. But that wouldn't be a truth. Okay, it's like saying, very good question. Everyone having his own religion or their own religion does not imply that truth is relative. Truth, by definition, is what? Is what things are. Someone said, truth, if you want to define truth, it's what corresponds to reality, what is real. If I say, today is, what is it, Sunday in North America. The truth of the matter is that today is Sunday in North America. You cannot come and tell me that today is Monday in North America. So truth is unchangeable, is fixed. So absolute truth indicates that this is an absolutely true statement for everybody. What people are advocating is that today could be Sunday for you if you want, but it's Monday for me.
Well, I don't think that's what people mean, though.
That's what they mean when it comes to religions, not when it comes to traffic lights or the stock market. Do you see? Okay, maybe offline we can have another discussion. Are we following? I can very well discuss that with them, but that's a whole different discussion. We have another lecture altogether about absolute truth, but that we can, and to give that answer justice, we can probably talk about it another time. You want to talk about it now? Okay. Absolute truth is revealed, discoverable, is not invented, but discoverable. Absolute truth is anchored in an absolute being. Absolute truth is personal. All these things, if you put them together, you will come up with one being that holds this absolute truth categorization or what? Right? And that being is God and the God of the scriptures. So we can have a definition of what absolute truth is, and it will always point back to Jesus Christ as being the absolute truth. And why is it we can logically talk about it, but just to keep the continuity of this, we'll finish. Do you mind? Okay. So, it's true for you, but not for me. Is that true for everybody? It cannot be true for everybody, because it's true for you, not for me. No one has the truth. No one has the truth. By the way, these statements, I have seen them and I've heard them numerous times, again, like I said, on college campuses. You obviously claim to have the truth. In order to know everyone is wrong, you must know what's right. You should not judge. What do you say to that?
That's a judgment.
That is a judgment, exactly. Is that a judgment? So what I'm trying to say is that these postmodern claims have illogical logical inconsistency built in these statements. Logical inconsistency. There is no coherence from a logical standpoint when you say that truth does not exist. By saying truth does not exist, you're implying that truth exists, or else your statement is meaningless. Someone said in one of the lectures, life is meaningless. Everything about life is meaningless. So the presenter of this lecture, the lecturer said, you don't mean that. And then the person said, yeah, I mean it. Life is meaningless. Well, if life is meaningless, how did you know that life is meaningless? You must have meaning for you to know that life is meaningless. If life is meaningless, then the statement you just made is also meaningless. Then you haven't said nothing. Sit down. You see? So what I'm trying to say is that logically speaking, you still didn't get it?
No, I
haven't. Okay. Let me know if I...
What differentiates them to us, for example, is that as Christians we are a body, a mass body of Christians that believe in one complete thing and, you know, it's the same. But as an atheist or an agnostic, these are subjects or individuals that stand out by themselves. There isn't a congregation called an atheist congregation. There are individuals that say to themselves, I believe I don't have a God, or I believe that this is not true. So when an argument like that stands, you're standing as an argument, arguing with a particular individual. It's not a body of individuals that believe in one thing.
Right. Good point, but I beg to differ on one thing that atheists, by the way, and I wish we all were downstairs listening to the talk about atheism. Atheists have tenets and beliefs that are common to all atheists. They vary. Some atheists say, I don't have enough faith in a supreme being. I lack the evidence. Some atheists would say, I have enough evidence that there is no God. So some passive and active or mild and aggressive atheists. But they all, for you to be called an atheist, you must have one common belief. And some people say, I don't believe in anything. That itself is a belief. That you don't believe in anything. So atheists, if you were to look at the Encyclopedia of Philosophy and get a definition of what atheism is it's common understanding of what atheists are, the lack of a belief in a supreme being. They don't believe in God. And these statements apply for all of them. Yeah, 1 second, we have a question.
Yeah.
I'm not talking exactly about this point, but I'm talking about they say that Christians and people who are religious, their morality is much inferior to people who don't
hear you.
Yeah, like it's not, it doesn't hold up to the people who are not Christians, for example. So there's like wars and, you know, that stuff happening. If they really believe in what they say, they should practice.
Very good. That actually, another question, very good point. Another question that I have on the, I may have it or may not on the food for thought section. What about all the atrocities that were committed in the name of Christ? All these, what about the Crusades? Do you mind if we park that to the Q&A session tomorrow? Okay. But by the way, the atheist that said that doesn't know how many atrocities were committed by atheists. So Stalin, Hitler, all these have killed millions of people. Sure.
And when I see, you know, Jesus said, for example, you know them by their fruit.
Right.
And if I look to Christians, and I see their Christian history, and I even see some Christian people that they are not as good as.
Very good. St. Augustine said, he didn't ask you to stop.
St. Augustine said that you don't judge a philosophy by its abuse.
Thank you. You don't judge a philosophy by
its abuse. Can you just stay right here? About 2 hours? No, I'm just gonna. How long do you guys want to? 10, 15 minutes? Oh, yeah. Okay.
And by the way, Christ said there will be many coming,
performing miracles and doing all these things in my name, and I will tell them what? I do not know you. So many will be professed Christians, but they're not really Christians. So those who say, I did this in the name of Christ are not really Christians because they haven't followed what
Christ stands for. So we can talk about it, but again, just think about it. You don't judge a philosophy by its abuse. Because there are so many abused systems that people claim to do things in the name of whatever, and then that's not necessarily the case. Okay.
Fulfill the prophecy. St. Paul said, for the time
will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears. Itching ears, ears cannot stand the truth. They will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned to fable. That is actually the times we're living in now. So our responsibility, now this is good, but fine. We've talked about the attacks, the enemy, the cultural attacks, humanism, materialism, hedonism, the ideological attacks, pluralism, atheism, relativism, all those isms, we talked about them. What is our responsibility? We ought to recognize that we are at war. When you want to win a battle, first and foremost,
you have to recognize that you are at war, or else you're bound to lose this battle. So we have to recognize that we are just not living in a Christian
country that is has got the cross as its symbol. That is absolutely the thing of the past. We are at a cultural war. And if there's anything that you want to take home out of this discussion, is that we are at an ideological, cultural war as Christians, as a body of Christ, that we need to wake up and understand where this war is coming from, and two other things. Understand who the enemy is, and I hope I have given you a glimpse of what that is. The enemy that comes to us via two fronts, the social and the ideological, and also the other third, more important thing is to understand what our weapons are. Because Christ did not just give us, sent us to the world without weapons that we can leverage. And those weapons are, if you read Ephesians 6, you'll see the full armor of God that we must take on against those fiery darts of Satan. So recognize that we're at war, understand who the enemy is, and understand what our weapons are. One other thing I mentioned downstairs is that to know how Christianity answers, heaven offers a fulfilling answers to life's most existential questions. What are the three, Mary, this is going to sound like a repetition, so I apologize. What are the three most important questions one must ask? Or any religion, worldview rather, must answer the three most existential questions of life.
What's the point of living?
Very good.
What will happen after death?
Very good. Excellent. Where did I come from? Why am I here? Where am I going? Where did I come from? Questions of origin. Why am I here? Questions of meaning. Where am I going? Questions of destiny. So you have to have origin, meaning, and destiny all answered by this worldview that you're espousing. None but the Christ or the God of the Bible that can answer or have a cohesive answer to these lives, to these questions that are life's most existential questions. The questions of origin, meaning, and destiny. Any of you have thought one time and said, where did I come from? Am I a product of evolution? Am I a product of matter and chance, as people mention? Did I just self-exist? Or my parents got together and got me? How did I get into this world? What is the questions of meaning? What's the meaning of life after all? Who provides meaning? What is the meaning of life? And what are the questions of destiny? Where am I going? You talk to someone, a Hindu, and I would say that you will probably, if you have good karma, you will be reincarnated into a more beautiful person, or maybe a muscular person, or whatever. Reincarnate? Are you going to be reincarnated? An atheist would say that if you die, what's your destiny? You cease to exist, huh? Be a tree? Yeah, that's a Hindu.
That's a naturalist. Let's say that. Naturalists believe that every natural order is the ultimate goal. Naturalists would say be a tree. Okay. Anyway. in conclusion, can I have exactly a few minutes and I'll open it for questions and answers. In conclusion, 2 Corinthians 10:5 will bring it back to the scriptures and all the answers that we have. By the way, and let me preface by saying that there are no new answers. There are no new news. One time, one philosopher said, there's no such a thing as new news. Every news is old news happening to new people. Every news is old news happening to new people. There's no such a thing as new when it comes to the Christian defense. St. Irenaeus, St. Cyril of Jerusalem, all these saints have done apologetics in the first century. What is different now is are the questions, not the answers. The questions are coming to us differently, but the answers are always the same. They just need to be packaged in a relevant way to the culture that we're living in. You see? No new answers. We're not coming up with something new. It's all in the scriptures. We just have to package the answer in a relevant way and do apologetics justice, you see, to defend our faith in a relevant way. So there's nothing new when it comes to this. So bring it back to the scriptures. St. Paul said, we are destroying speculations that may be lawfully raised up against knowledge of God. We are taking every thought captive. We've taken every thought captive. Every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. He implies that there's some kind of what? War. If you're taking thoughts captive, captive from what? A war that we are undergoing. In another verse he says, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit or empty deception. According to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principle of the world, rather than according to Christ. So here's an interesting contrast. Either we take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, or we run the risk of being taken captive by empty deception. There is no middle ground. There's no neutral ground. You either take every thought, every fiery dart, as St. Paul says, every fiery dart, cultural dart, that you will be experiencing in college and beyond, captive, and be able to defend that faith that you have, that you were given from generation to generation, and be able to share that faith. Either you do this, or you're going to fall victim to the cultural trend and become captive yourself, and you will follow. And I have seen, unfortunately speaking, some of our youth, not so much, probably two, had fallen victim to this trend of pluralism. And they were Coptic youth, go to church, take communion, confess and all that. They went to college. And they had those three questions in college. Where did it come from? What's the meaning of life? Actually, the most important was the second question. What's the meaning of life? And they started to talk about meaning and meaning and meaning. Of course, they had friends that influenced their thought about how we should all believe the same thing, tolerance and diversity, all religions are good. They now come after being solid Coptic youth in the church. She now has come and became a not an agnostic, but someone who believes everything is good. Christianity is just one of other religions that the world offers, and I don't necessarily have to hold that it's true, because it's all good, and it's very intolerant to believe that only Christianity is the true faith. She fell victim to what? To this cultural fiery dart, cultural thought. So if you either take every thought captive, or you run the risk of being taken captive. And that's the main reason why we're sharing this discussion in this convention, that has the theme of faith. For you to strengthen that faith, you must have that. Lastly, I wanted to give you some suggested readings. If you're interested to discuss, to discover more, to learn more about these topics, Relativism is a great book labeled Feet Firmly Planted in Midair. Feet Firmly Planted in Midair by Gregory Kukul and Francis Beckwith. Great book. The New Tolerance by Josh McDowell. I'm sure you've heard of Josh McDowell. You have? The Universe Next Door, this book is a bit heavy in philosophy, by James Sire, talks about worldviews. This book, great book, called Ethics, Being Bold in a Whatever World, Being Bold in a Whatever, quote unquote, World, written by Sean McDowell, who's the son of Josh McDowell. Postmodern Times by Jean Philippe and Truth Decay by Douglas Griffiths. Truth Decay, in other words, truth is now decayed from our society. Great books, I've read them, and I recommend if you are interested in reading more about this stuff. So, I should probably
stop and pause and ask for questions, or maybe comments or questions on this, please. I hope at least I have given you an idea of the topic of apologetics. Yes, ma'am.
I just want to say that most people we meet, I mean, at least me, most people I meet, and they claim they don't believe in anything, it's not because they have thought about it. Most of them, it's just the easy way. They haven't read anything, they haven't explored, they just say this because this is the only thing they can say. So all these arguments that you have given us, it doesn't help that much because they don't care.
Very good point. In other words, I could have saved myself and your time.
Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding. No. And fly from San Francisco and all this, but no, seriously, I see your point. I don't know what to say, but anyways, let me throw it back on you. If they don't care and they don't know, then the burden is upon you to show them and educate them. They want someone like you to do that. People don't need arguments. People don't need intellectual philosophies. That's not what people need. People need someone that can relationally relate to them. And that's how Christ works. Christ did not come and say, let me argue how I am Christ. He didn't argue in a philosophical way. He worked love, compassion, peace, all these beautiful things that Christ had offered. However, it is also important for you. There are two, we're going to talk about defending the faith, witnessing to Christ. There are two ways we can do this. The person that is sitting next to you that doesn't know and doesn't care, and I call it intellectual laziness. They don't know any better. Okay? Then you have two barriers that you as a Christian need to cross. Two barriers. Either intellectual or emotional. I don't believe in God because I'm intellectually not convinced, and there are a lot of people like that. Stephen Hawking, Anthony Flew, I can name you 200 atheists that have come to Christ, to Christianity, on an intellectual level. They had a problem intellectually. So you must know that front. The other barrier is the emotional barrier. Well, I don't feel that God exists for me. I feel there's so much pain in the world. I feel this, or he hasn't really helped me in my agony, in my times of need. This is when you come in the picture and you offer that image of Christ to him or to her. You see? So, I wouldn't disregard this completely, because there are, and I know you don't mean that, I know you don't. But there are barriers that are intellectual. As a Christian, I need to know my faith and defend it intellectually as well as emotionally and relationally. I need to.
You should just throw a bunch of questions at them.
It's a lecture for high school, but witnessing to Christ, there are tactics and ways to witness the faith, the faith of Christ to others, and it's not just throwing questions. Like I said earlier, we don't want to win arguments. You can win the argument, but lose the person. You want to win the soul. How do you do that? There's an art behind it, of course, through the help of the Holy Spirit. And you're not winning anything. It's God using you as an instrument. Let me just take that question.
Just as another point, this happened to me actually with a friend. It's not that she denies Christianity or anything like that, but she has associated Christianity with society to the extent that she hasn't accepted God into her life, because every church that she has gone to, she has claimed that the people haven't been friendly to her, or that the priests haven't been accepting of her. So I think it's also something as Christians, we really need to work on, because I mean, we're human beings, you know, in the end of it, although Christianity teaches us morals and, you know, we must be good and friendly and accepting of everything that's around us, we still judge nonetheless people. So it's definitely something that we have to look at as well and reflect upon, is that we might be scaring these people off to a certain extent.
Excellent point. I couldn't agree with you more. Excellent point. And this is the entry to so many people's hearts. People need that. And this is how Christ, by the way, entered into these people's hearts. We talk about all the encounters with the Samaritan woman, with Zacchaeus, all the encounters in the scriptures. Christ entered through what we call the existential level, the level of emotions and beings. Yes? Any other questions?
I just wanted to say something in
reply
to Mary.
I have come across some people that have come up to me and actually asked me, trying to, like, they are atheists and they're trying to, I guess, kind of throw me off somehow. So I think that they are somewhat curious as well, and they do want to find an answer. And the fact that some people, they actually do write books with regards to atheism and atheism, they do want to know, but they haven't been able to,
right,
to come up with something that actually is able to answer.
Very good. And there are, and I have come through so many good points, so many, and we ought to be able to give an answer. Christ said, St. Peter said in 1 Peter 3:15, always be ready to give an answer. You're commanded to give an answer, but not to give an answer to win the argument. Again, that's a very important distinction. Give an answer to win the person and the soul of the person. Yes, I'm sorry,
Mary,
I'll
come back to you. Well, I just wanted to comment on something. Like, in college, I've come across a lot of atheists. It's to the point, like, the majority of the people at the college that I go to, they're all atheists to some extent. But really, what I've noticed is that the smart atheists, they're like the lost sheep that Christ has, you know, that Christ has been compared to, you know, finding the one sheep out of the 99. And they're really looking for answers. Like, they need someone there to explain to them. If someone does explain to them, they will turn to Christ. And that's what we have to remember.
Very good. Very good. Absolutely. And we are called to do that. Very good point.
I just wanted to respond to Dina, because I recently had a similar encounter with my roommate that I'm living with in Victoria, who said the exact same thing. She was like, well, you know, Christians are so judgmental, and all the wars, there's just been so many injustices and so many wars and battles and people been killed over religion. And so I don't want to have anything to do with religion because it's resulted in so much evil in the world. And so, I mean, obviously, like, that's a really common argument. And the way I responded to her was, yeah, that's true. But if you go to the essence and the message and the spirit of the doctrine and of the Bible, you don't see that. I was basically like, people manipulate messages to further their own agendas, to further their own power, their pride, their whatever. But if you go to the essence of Christianity, it says something very different. So that's how I was able to respond to it. But how would you, like, from an apologetics perspective, respond to something like that?
One thing, as I mentioned, St. Augustine said that you don't judge a philosophy by its abuse, because so many philosophies are being abused, and this abuse is attributed to that worldview. Number one. Number two, Christ himself in the scriptures, like I said, probably said that so many will come in my name and do this and this and this and miracles and all that, and he's going to tell them, go away, I don't know you. Indicates that just doing something in the name of Christ doesn't imply you're a Christian. So we must make that distinction between Christianity and Christians. Gandhi said something that's very common and famous. Do you guys know what Gandhi said?
Yeah.
What did he say?
If it wasn't for Christians,
I'd be Christian.
Exactly. If it wasn't for Christians, I would be a Christian. This is something that we ought to take and not say, I'm not trying to be judgmental, but I'm saying, okay, how can I change that perception? Let's not worry about all those Christians that did all these things. Let's worry about me. How am I to the world, I'm basically radiating. I'm being like a prism, radiates light. I take in the light, and I go like this to reflect it onto others. How am I reflecting the light onto others? That should be the question. Not so much the questions of all these other atrocities in the name of Christ. There's a distinction between Christianity and Christians. And not everybody that does anything in the name of Christ would be necessarily called a Christian. Any other questions? Any other comments? Yes. She had her hands up first. One second.
This is
the video.
Yeah.
Okay,
I just curious, like, what is your ultimate goal as going around campuses? And trying to defend Christianity, and, like, what are you trying to get at? Like, what's the point of it?
Okay.
Not in a
defensive way. No. What's the point? The point is this. I feel personally that I grew up in Egypt, and I know that in Egypt when I was in Egypt until I was 14 years old, that we didn't deal with anything. I didn't deal with things like that. You come to the West, And being a youth servant serves, you know, the college and beyond, and graduates and all that, and ask, or being asked questions that haven't been asked by a typical Coptic community. So ask questions that I didn't have answers for. So 8 years ago, I was talking to His Grace Mbe Yusuf, I'm giving you the whole story. And I told him, we need to, as Coptic servants, engage more in these challenges that face our youth and the West in general, in America and Canada. So we need to actually equip ourselves as servants so that we can defend those questions. So I, from that, about nine years ago, we started to, under his guidance, work on the field of apologetics and so on and so forth. So we would go to college campuses, and I would basically represent the Christian worldview perspective when I see a Buddhist or a Muslim or an atheist being so loud. Those who don't know anything, those who are fertile ground for anything that falls in, they will fall. People that are skeptics, I don't know. I just want somebody to tell me what the truth is. Muslims will snatch those people like whatever. Buddhists, so many people, so many other faiths and religions will snatch those people that are questioning. Why not Christianity? Why not us as Christians? Why do we have to say, well, let the evangelicals do it, or let the Catholics do it? Why not Coptic Orthodox Christianity go out there, represent Christianity to those who are skeptics, and make people basically uncover all these questioning about the faith of Christianity? So that's, from that respect, it is not going out there to debate, or going out there to prove that Christianity is right and you're all wrong. It is not in that, because that wouldn't be Christianity. Then I would be defeating the purpose. It's going to answer, it's going to these students and answering the most, giving them the most fulfilling answers to the most existential questions of their lives. Yes, he had a question back there.
What, over there? When somebody came to you and said that there are a lot of people that were not Christians, I think it's very important to pinpoint what evil they were talking about. So for example, if it's the Second World War, like you said, Hitler was an atheist, he was a Christian, and also it's very important to go back to the actual scriptures, because Muslims, they use the same argument. Muslims say, oh, Islam is a religious peace, but, you know, these things that Muslims do around the world, oh, they just listen to the Quran. Yeah, but I mean, when you go to the Quran, it literally tells people to kill infidels and so on and so forth. But there's nothing like this in the Bible. So it's very important to be asked about the event that you're talking about and also go back to the actual scriptures and learn the truth.
But let me tell you something. You said go back to the scriptures. Can I tell you something? How many Bibles do we have? How many Gospels do we have? Not four, five. There's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the Christian. And most people out there will not get a chance to read the first four. They will read you and I. So you must be the Bible to everybody else to read. So we can say, go back to the Bible. No, look at me. And I'll tell you a quick story. Pachomius from the Church Fathers. Saint Pachomius, how did he become the great Saint Pachomius? Sorry, I butchered the story. So how did he become Saint Pachomius? By being a prisoner of war, POW, and then he was being a POW in some Christian village, and some people, he expected to be killed and tortured, and they actually hosted him, and they gave him food and water and shelter and all that. And he said, who's your God? You treated me so nice. I must follow the God you're following. And he became Saint Pachomius. So what I'm trying to say is that you're the fifth Bible that people will most likely get to read, not the first four. Any other question? Okay, one last question and then we'll...
The follow-up is really important because sometimes we make people jump out of their wrong boats because we leave them in the sea drowning. So you can't just have one discussion with one person in a campus or in work or lunch time or whatever and then leave them because they need follow-up.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. Follow-up will make them feel that you're genuine and sincere in what you're saying. Okay, well thank you very much for...